one of the real bedrock beliefs among Republicans is that if you cut taxes, particularly on the wealthiest people in America, the economy will prosper. We hear that over and over again. Didn't we try that experiment under President George W. Bush? Didn't the debt of the United States double under the president, and he left a shambles behind him? 2.3 million jobs lost in the first 3 months of President Obama's administration because of this failed economic policy, which you continue to espouse, that if we cut taxes on the rich, America is going to get wealthier? Haven't we tried it? Where are the jobs?
Could I take a little trip down memory lane with my friend from Illinois, who I had the great privilege many years ago, I don't know if I should mention, 1982 election, he and I came to the House of Representatives together. And you might recall that one of his own, then a Democrat congressman from Texas, got together with President Reagan, and guess what we did? We cut taxes, and guess what? We had one of the strongest recoveries in recent history of this country. Because we didn't start spending and add spending without paying for them. And I would say the senator from Illinois, he is correct. The spending that went on in the previous administration was not acceptable and led to the deficit. Let me just finish. But I would also say, speaking for myself, I voted against the Medicare Part D because it was not paid for. I voted against the earmark and pork barrel spending, which were abundant as every appropriations bill came to the floor and dramatically increased spending in the worst way, wasteful and corrupt way, I will say. And I'm proud that at least some of us said, if you don't stop this spending and get it under control, then you're going to face a serious problem. But I would also mention, and you've seen the chart, it's gotten a lot worse, since the last election. And you can't keep BIOB, you can't keep up blaming on Bush. Go ahead.
I'd like to respond to my colleague through the chair, my colleague from Arizona. Does he recall what happened with the Reagan tax cuts? Because what happened was we tripled the national debt during that period of time, and President Reagan came to Congress 18 times to extend the debt ceiling. He holds the record. So to argue the Reagan tax cuts led to great long-term prosperity is, I think, seriously in doubt if you're going to use the deficit as a measure.
If I could say, we believed, and Reagan believed, that cutting tax cuts would restore our economy, which was in the tank thanks to the practices of the previous administration before him. And Reagan presided over probably one of the greatest job creation periods in the history of this country. And those are numbers that I would be glad to insert in the record. Compare that with what has happened since this administration took office, with the promise that if we passed Obamacare, if we passed TARP, if we passed all of these others, that the economy would then be restored and grow. And again, it's hard for my dear friend from Illinois to refute the fact that they categorically stated that if we passed the stimulus package, that unemployment would be at a maximum of 8%. Unemployment today is 9.2%, and if you look at any indicator, whether it be housing starts, whether it be the deficit, whether it be unemployed, whatever it is, it's gotten worse since the stimulus package was passed rather than better.
Would the senator yield for a question? Does the senator believe...
Well, I'd be glad to just hear your comment.
Well, I'm going to give you a chance to speak again.
Yeah.
Well, does the senator believe that defaulting on our national debt for the first time in our history, which has been the threat looming over us from the House Republicans and others for a long period, is good for America's economy? One of his colleagues on the floor here from the state of Pennsylvania has come in and said, listen, defaulting on the debt is not that big a deal. It can be, quote, in his words, easily managed. Does the senator from Arizona agree with that thinking?
As the senator may know, I came to the floor a couple of days ago and made the comment, and that the senator from Illinois and I are in agreement. Point number one, you can prioritize. I think the senator and every economist that I know literally would agree. You can prioritize for a while where you want what remaining money is left. But the message you send to the world, not just our markets, but to the world, that the United States of America is going to default on its debts is a totally unacceptable scenario and beneath a great nation. We are in agreement, number one.
Amen.
Number two is, that to insist that any agreement is based on the passage through the United States Senate of a balanced budget amendment to the Constitution of the United States, as I said before, is not fair to the American people because the terrible obstructionists on this side of the aisle, the terrible people, their flawed philosophical views about the future of America, is not going to allow us to get 20 additional votes from your side, assuming that you get all 47, since it requires 67 votes to pass a balanced budget amendment of the Constitution.
Mr. President, it pays.
So I think it was not only wrong assessment, I think it's not fair to the American people to say that we can pass a balanced budget amendment of the Constitution through the Senate at this time. This kind of discussion, I think, is important, number one. Number two is we should have this national debate on other forms besides just the Sunday show, and perhaps the floor of the Senate is the best place to do that. And I want to continue to engage with the senator from Illinois. But I hope that this agreement will assure the American people that we will meet our obligations, that we will meet our obligations not only physically, but fiscally, but also meet our obligations to them to govern, because they did send us here to govern. I think the senator from Illinois would agree with me. The last approval rating of Congress I saw both sides of the aisle was about 16%, and I've yet to encounter anyone in that 16% category in my travels back to my state. And by the way, I would like to note the presence of the Budget Committee chairman here, Senator Conrad, who I think has made enormous good faith efforts to reach an agreement on some of these issues. And I thank him for his work, and I want to assure him his reward will be in heaven, not here on earth. Does the senator from Illinois have?
I'd also like to thank the senator from Arizona for the few minutes that we've shared on the floor, and I really hope more members will do this. Rather than just taking turns giving speeches, these exchanges, even when we disagree, are valuable. But I hope at the end of the day, I agree completely with the senator from Arizona. At the end of the day, we cannot allow our economy to lapse into this default. It will be devastating to a lot of innocent families and businesses across America and will cost us dearly in terms of our national debt. So let us hope that we can find this bipartisan agreement that people are working on even at this moment.